Stand by.
3, 2, 1.
The following program comes from executive producer Lilian Garcia.
Every athlete is on this quest. Every performer dives in
head first,
battling real life challenges and overcoming obstacles in an effort to make their dreams reality.
Reality.
Singer, songwriter, 15-year WWE host Lilian Garcia was the first woman to ever announce WrestleMania.
And the first to launch her own podcast,
which gives you an all-access pass to the human interest stories of elite athletes
and extraordinary entertainers.
Now, let's embark on another fascinating journey
of chasing glory
with your host, Lilian Garcia.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to Chasing Glory. As you can tell, I'm a little bit under the weather. That's right. I've got a respiratory infection. I am fighting through this. I actually feel okay. I just don't sound very good. But hey, the show must go on. So here I am. And what a week. What a week. I got to debut on PFL MMA in the MMA world. It was so much fun. And it was just so great to be received with such open arms by the fans, by the critics, by all of you, with all your comments, with all your support and your love. I really, really appreciate it. It really helped me a lot, especially because this infection, this is what nobody knows, this infection attacked me the night before my debut. That's right. The whole night I was up and it was awful. I was taking Benadryl and Mucinex and this and that, trying to, you know, just get it to not attack me, but it did. And so the next day I called my doctor, got some antibiotics, and that's how I debuted. It's under antibiotics. It was so stressful trying to figure everything that I had to do and be, you know, be at my, on my A game and be sick on top of it. But you know what? I think it's a great lesson. You just got to keep going. And I made a choice. I made a choice not to panic. I made a choice to do whatever I could, what I can control. And that's what I did. And I made a choice to lean on all of you for support. And I appreciate it again. Thank you. Thank you to the PFL, the team there. Amazing. They really prepped me for that. And, you know, I've got some work to do. I've got some work to do. It's a whole new game for me in a way. Yes, I've been announcing, but this is different and I'm seeing the differences in it. So I'm ready for the challenge and I'm studying hard for the next one, which will be on May 23rd. Don't miss PFL 2. So much fun with the regular season and then the playoffs and then the championship. That's fun. That's fun. So I love this format with the PFL. So again, thank you to the entire team there. Thank you to you guys. And more than anything, thank you to the WWE. If it wasn't for the WWE giving me an opportunity back in 1999 when I debuted there as an announcer who knew nothing about how to be an announcer, like nothing. And to now be in the position that I'm at, it's because of Vince and Kevin and the staff there that gave me an opportunity to build and to get better and better and grow with the company and, you know, just a 15 beautiful year career there. So thank you to WWE, seriously, for opening the door. That is why I'm in the MMA now, if it wouldn't have been for the WWE. And I wanted to talk about the review of the week because I think this is a great segue to where the show is too. So the review of the week, remember that you can put these on Apple Podcast, and when you submit it, it puts you into a drawing. Every week, somebody goes into a drawing, gets picked, right? And then at the end of the month, we pick a winner out of the entire month, and then you get an 8x10 autographed and a Chasing Glory t-shirt. And we did get in touch with last week's winner, by the way. Remember, she was in Buenos Aires, Argentina. And we were wondering, how the heck are we going to get the shirt to her? But we got in touch with her, so it is on its way. Very excited. Anyway, so this one is titled Pro Wrestling Meets Self-Help. This is from Hippo San Wrestling. My sister and I look forward to finding out every Friday who will be on the show for Monday. Oh, that's right. For you guys out there, the way you can find out is go to @ChasingGloryPodcast on Instagram. And we have Glory Friday, which announces who our next guest for Monday is. Anyway, all right, to be honest, it doesn't matter if you are not a fan of the person that she has on, because by the time the podcast interview is over, you have learned so much, and that's a beautiful thing. It's an emotionally powerful podcast, so definitely have tissues handy. It's extremely well done. Definitely check it out. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Great review, and that is what I mean about the segue, is I want you guys to realize this is not just a wrestling podcast. This is a podcast where I interview a lot of other athletes, and I interview like Sean O'Connell, right? From last week, MMA, how he felt like he's just a regular guy. And in many ways he is. And then he went in there though with such a mindset that he ended up winning his division in the PFL and winning the $1 million. And then to hear his whole journey of how the $1 million has changed or not changed his life. So if you didn't get to hear it, definitely go back and listen to it, because there's a lot of amazing lessons in that one. But I also interview other entertainers, singers, wellness coaches. Again, it's a podcast about people that are chasing their glory and everything that they've endured and the lessons that they can share with all of you. And so that brings me to Trent Shelton. Man, so I discovered Trent when I was on the movie set. So if you haven't heard, by the way, I think it drops, it like comes out this week. It's crazy. So much is going on. So I'm in a movie. It's a documentary. It's called Perception, Seeing is Not Believing. So I'm part of hosting the movie on screen, which is a lot of fun. But anyway, so Trent, while I was on the movie set, he was there, and he was, when I walked in, my time call was different. So when I walked in, he was already in full action, and I hear this guy down the hallway, and he's just in it, man. He is preaching. What I mean by that, I just mean like really sharing the lessons that he's learned and his path that he's gone through and what he's doing to help people. Right. So I'm hearing this, I'm like, holy cow, I am so inspired. Who is this guy? And so I meet Trent Shelton. Well, lo and behold, I'm one of the few ones that don't know him, because he's got like over 1 billion views on Facebook. So a lot of people are already following Trent Shelton. But, you know, sometimes we don't know, like, you know, they come at the time that you're supposed to hear. So anyway, so Trent Shelton, I kept hearing his whole dialogue that day, and I was like, man, this guy's good. And then when I met him, just so down to earth. And then we kept connecting, because we were promoting between the movie and then the event, the Powerful You event this weekend. So we've been together a lot. And so I said, look, I would love to do a Chasing Glory story on you. He's like, absolutely, let's do it. So we actually sat out on the rooftop. It was a few weeks ago here in LA, and we just had a conversation that I feel is so inspiring and can help so many of you, including me. It helped me a lot too. So I'm glad that you're going to be listening to this episode and getting to know Trent. And if you already know Trent, then you know how great he is. And you also know that every time you hear him, you can learn something new. So I appreciate that all of you are taking the time to listen to this interview, and I appreciate that from Trent. And just before we segue right into that, I want to remind you about Powerful You, because we do speak about Powerful You. We're both speaking at Powerful You event. I'm actually co-hosting the event as well. And the surprise was I was also going to be singing. Now, we'll see if I can do that or not. It just depends on this respiratory thing that's going on. I'm seeing my ear, nose, and throat doctor this week, and so hopefully I can, because I had a great little surprise. But anyway, we'll see what happens. So Powerful You, 17th through the 19th in Los Angeles at the LA Convention Center. If you're anywhere in the LA area or you can get over here, get over here. 3 days, I'm telling you. By the time you leave on Sunday, you're not the same person that you walked in on Friday. Wouldn't that be amazing if you could actually get the tools to get your life where you want it to be? And the greatest thing about this is how inexpensive it is to attend, because the couple who is putting this all together, I mean, this is self-funded. They want to help people. They've been at rock bottom rock bottom, and they want to help people. And so they said, we're going to make this accessible. So go on powerful-u.com and you'll see how tickets are even as low as $25 for the entire 3 days. That's crazy. It's unheard of. 30 plus top world speakers there with lots of tools as to how you guys can get to your next level. So don't let anything stop you, especially you. Don't be the thing that stands in your way. Okay? Give it a try. You never know. Give it a try. So that's powerful-u.com. All right. So without further ado, here is Trent Shelton's journey of chasing glory. Born in Little Rock, Arkansas, Trent Shelton grew up a star athlete and earned a spot on the Baylor University football team, where he set a school record with receptions in 45 consecutive games. Even though he went undrafted in the 2007 NFL draft, Trent stayed motivated and focused and would go on to be a member of the Colts, Seahawks, and Redskins rosters. Unfortunately, his NFL career wouldn't pan out the way that he envisioned it, and after football had been part of his entire life, Trent struggled finding a path in the next portion of his life. After being directionless, he would finally find the right path when tragedy and triumph intersected his life. Unfortunately, one of his best friends committed suicide, which coincided with the birth of his first son. Therefore, he would make a promise that he would live with meaning for the rest of his life. From then on, Trent would begin sharing his new purpose of making sure to not run from your battles and to eliminate negativity. In the process of sharing his journey, he would turn to motivational speaking, and through his numerous speaking engagements and relatable life lessons, he has gained a massive following with nearly 10 million Facebook followers and nearly 350,000 YouTube subscribers. Trent most recently released a book entitled The Greatest You: Face Reality, Release Negativity, and Live Your Purpose, where he shares many of his own personal stories and how people can bring out the absolute best in themselves and for future generations. Although football did not quite work out for him, Trent Shelton has found new ways to inspire people all over the world. It's about to get real, raw, and inspiring with Trent Shelton. All right, guys, I am so excited to be sitting here with Trent Shelton, somebody that I have gotten to know over the past few months and somebody that I'm so inspired by. And yet I'm very intrigued as to who you are, because you are somebody that you're dominating this world, but this is not what you set out to do, was be a motivational speaker. First of all, welcome to Chasing Glory. Thank you, because I know you've got a crazy schedule, and I appreciate you fitting this in.
Thanks for having me, and it's an honor to be here. I appreciate you.
Thank you. You know, just to let you guys know, as you know, I'm always as real as possible. We are here in Hollywood, and we're just on the roof deck having this chill. I wanted to pick a place where, after having, you know, a day where you've done one show after another, you can just hang. And so, guys, if you hear an ambulance or police, you know, car or something like that, you'll know it's real.
It's real. I love it.
It's real. So, Trent, my audience, they've been so amazing in traveling this journey with me of chasing glory, hearing everybody's different story of their chase for glory. And all of us as human beings, we're in some chase of glory or another.
Right.
Absolutely. Everyone's story is so different. And I think more than anything, people are realizing that whatever they're going through, they're not alone.
Right.
Yeah. And I know that you're a big component of telling people that you're not alone. You have a lot of videos about different things in your life. Now, tell me, because I know you come from football, and you absolutely loved football, and you were, like, that's what you thought you were going to be.
Right.
Give me a little bit of your backstory as to what football meant to you. What was that chase for glory?
Yeah, so football for me started when I was, I can remember walking. You know, I had two older brothers, so I always wanted to, you know, fit in with them, and I always wanted to follow them. So they started playing sports at a very young age, and me being the baby boy, My very first football game padded was when I was 6 years old.
Wow.
And so that's all that I ever knew. It's all that I ever wanted to be. You know, that was my identity. There was no other option. That was my dream. You know, if that dream came true, I felt like I would, you know, life would be over, you know, if I made it to the NFL. So at a very young age, I set my sights, not just on the NFL, but sports. I mean, I played baseball, I played basketball, football, track. I did it all. And, yeah, that's what I wanted to do. And I was a standout. I mean, the first three times I touched the football, they all went for touchdowns.
Really?
All went for touchdowns. Man, I have like video of it. Like.
But when you start that high, man, where do you go from there?
Exactly. So it was just like, and I dominated it. And I was blessed to have an uncle who coached in the NFL. And so I got to go to training camps periodically, not very often, but got to see Jerry Rice and got to see, you know, all these guys. And then I lived across the street from a New Orleans Saints player, so I got to meet certain guys. So it became very tangible for me. I'm like, okay, this really can happen. Because, you know, sometimes you have a dream, it's like, I don't know if it can happen, but yeah. It's like, this really could happen. And, you know, kind of to fast forward, you know, peewee football, you know, all the way up to middle school, I was a standout. We moved to Texas in seventh grade. I was living in New Orleans and came to Texas, and I kind of had a setback because when I came to Texas, see, New Orleans, it's, you know, if you're in sixth grade, it's one team, sixth, seventh, and eighth. Texas, you have three teams in each grade, so you have an A, B, C team. So I get there, and the coach doesn't know me. He puts me on C team. So I go home, I tell my dad. My dad's like, wow, there must be some great players in Texas if you're on C team. And to make a long story short, like, I actually had to hurt a guy for me to get moved up to A team. Like,
what
I had,
do you mean?
Like, basically, I was playing defense, and I hit a guy, and hurt himself really bad. He was crying. And that immediately told the coach that I was a good player, I guess, and moved me right up. So I came home and was like, Dad, I'm on 18.
Do you remember that moment?
Yeah, I do.
How did it feel knowing that you hurt someone and then that elevated you?
I mean, with football, just to be honest, it felt good just because it was football. Like, I mean, the kid wasn't hurt, like, bad, but mm-hmm. He was hurt enough, you know? And in football, you get praised for that. I mean, you get praised for big hits. You get praised for, you know, everybody's your opponent, even on your team if it's during practice. So looking back, I mean, it probably shouldn't have felt as great as it felt, but I was willing to do anything I had to do to earn my respect in Texas, you know? And I told my dad, and I ended up being 18 quarterback before it was all said and done. And high school, same thing, was all state and all that type of stuff. Got a full scholarship to Baylor.
Oh, wow.
And that was always my goal, too, because I wanted to, like, that was kind of my why. I always wanted to give back to my parents. Like, I didn't want my parents to have to pay for college. They'd done so much for us. And took care of my grades, too, where I could have probably went academically, too. My dad always told me, it's like, if football doesn't work out, make sure you take care of your grades, be a champion in everything that you do. And I went to Baylor, and I got redshirted my first year, which I set out, which was good because I was 180. And then after my redshirt year, I got up to 200 pounds. So I gained 20 pounds.
Wow.
And, I had a great career. I feel like I was still kind of, it wasn't the career I wanted, but it was still a great career, all Big 12. So it comes to after my senior year, and I'm projected to go late round. And of course I don't get drafted. And, you know, that's like the first shot of my confidence when I look back, is like feeling like I'm not enough. Even though I didn't show it, my parents are like, are you okay? And you're watching all these draft picks. I'm like, yeah, I'm okay, but I'm not okay. And I didn't get drafted, but as soon as the draft is over, they're called high-priority free agents, meaning that a team was probably going to pick you. They just didn't, but they want to get you. So they give you a good signing bonus. My phone was ringing off the hook. Got some advice from my uncle, who was in the NFL. He's like, don't go to that team. I don't care how much they want to pay you. Don't go there because I know their staff. Mm. And he was like, go here. And it was Coach Dungy with the Indianapolis Colts right after they won the Super Bowl. He's like, he's going to give you a fair shake. Just go there. I know him as a guy. And I went to the Colts, and
Are you glad?
Yeah, I am. I am. I kind of hesitated with that because.
Yeah, I saw your face.
Yeah, because I just feel like looking back, and this isn't to put blame. It's just the business. I didn't know how much the NFL was a business.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't know that. I mean, you don't know it till you get in it.
Right.
And so they had drafted two receivers. And so if me knowing that, if I'm thinking, okay, it doesn't matter who they draft. Like, if I outplay them, I'm going to play. It's not the case. They invested millions of dollars in these guys.
Right.
They're going to give them every opportunity. I mean, it's a business decision.
Right.
So if I would have knew that, I probably wouldn't have went there. But going there, it really changed my mindset. So I get there, and just kind of to fast forward, preseason, I had the best preseason of all the rookies in the NFL. Mm. Like, I balled out. I was a starting, as they call it, gunner, because if you're a free agent, you got to make the team on special teams, because more than likely, you might be a fifth, fourth string receiver, so you got to contribute on special teams. I was playing great. We get to the third preseason game, and they don't play me. And so I'm just like, this is odd. You know, and usually the third preseason game, the starters play the first two quarters, but then, you know, the guys fighting to make the team come mm-hmm. in. And so I asked one of the veteran receivers, I'm like, hey, man, like, why aren't they playing me? And he was like, they're trying to hide you. I was like, what do you mean? He's like, they want to keep your stats low enough where other teams won't get you, because they're probably going to cut you and sign you to the practice squad. So they want to keep your stats low so you don't become so attractive to other teams.
Whoa.
And that was the case. That's exactly what happened. They cut me, and they signed me to the practice squad. You know, they told me, like, you know, we want to develop you. We love you as a player. And I believed it. I believe they did, because, I mean, I played great.
Yeah.
And I bought a car. As soon as I knew I was on the team, I went and bought a car, because that was always my thing. I was like, I'm going to buy a car when I sign.
Yeah.
And I got an apartment, and 2 weeks into me being in Indianapolis, they called me and I got cut.
But did they say why?
Yeah, they tell you why. They say it's a numbers game. That's the why. They say, we really love you as a player, but it's a numbers game. So I've heard that so many times throughout my career in the NFL. And so I drive back from Texas to Indiana. Luckily, I had a roommate that made the active roster. So he's like, cool, man, I got it. Man, I'll just have a two-bedroom apartment. Don't worry about it. So I'd have to fight to get out of my lease.
Yeah.
And I drive back to Texas, a lonely drive, and I bottled myself in my house because it's season. So, I mean, not a lot of people from your city make it to the NFL. You know, like, mm-hmm. I mean, Dallas-Fort Worth is a big city, so you might have a few, but in your hometown, people know that. So if I'm at home, people know, wait a minute, it's September, why are you here?
Mm.
And so I didn't go out.
Because you didn't want anybody to know that you got cut.
I didn't want to face that.
Wow.
I didn't want to have to answer those questions at all.
Yeah.
And so I bottled myself in my mom's guest room, because that's where the computer and stuff was. And it's funny, because that's where rehab time pretty much started. And I just stayed in the house, and then I got a call a week later from Indianapolis, and they brought me back.
Wow. I mean, to take me to that roller coaster, because that had to be freaking crazy.
It's crazy because they brought me back. And
but take me before bringing you back. Like,
how I was feeling?
How are you feeling? I mean, I know you're hiding.
Yeah, I was feeling like that was the first time in my life I felt like I didn't have something under control. And so I'm thinking, like, what now? I became angry in my faith. I started to play the blame game.
Yeah.
It's like, I was like, man, why? Like, I could have just, like, been a sorry football player and not even made it this far, and my life could be so much further. It's like, you know, because in college, just being honest, as an athlete, they don't prepare you for life after sports. They say it's student-athlete. No, it's athlete-student. Like, you can't do internships, at least when I was playing. You don't have time to do it, so they don't prepare you for life after sports. So I'm like, what do I do in my life? Yeah, I have a speech communications degree, but it's like, what am I going to do with that?
Yeah.
And so I felt like I didn't, for the first time, that I didn't have any control in my life or over my life. And I started to turn to things that I knew would numb the pain. You know, started drinking, started smoking, popping pills at that time in my life, going out to parties and clubs to run from the reality. And that was starting that process. And I got a call back. Probably a week later, they brought me back up. And when I got up to Indy, I was on practice squad, played great, but I got caught up in the lifestyle. You know, I got caught up in, you know, because growing up as a kid, you know, where I'm from, it's like success is money, it's parties, it's VIP, it's being famous.
Yeah.
That's success.
Yeah.
You know, so
the car,
right? The watch, everything. So I had to get these things. Not because I wanted them. It's cool if you want them, but I wanted them because I had to show people that I made it, that I was successful. So I went to the VIP parties when I probably should have been at home in my playbook. I was partying with people who were like on the team, like good, like veterans, like they're not going nowhere. So I'm out partying with them. And like the team has, I don't want to call them spies, but they have people out.
They're watching.
Yeah, and it's like Trent is, you know, I don't know, this guy's always out. Like,
yeah.
And I didn't even realize that.
Yeah.
And so, you know, I'm getting to be around these rappers and people I looked up to, and I'm rubbing elbows with like all these famous people. So I'm like, this is the life. And I was still playing good, but it was like I would get drunk on, you know, a Tuesday night randomly and then go to practice Wednesday. And, you know, I was able to manage, but I'm just like, man, if I was actually, like, sober and, like, actually focused, like, just imagine how, like, better I would have been,
yeah.
You know, showing up. And so that's kind of how my career went with Indy, back and forth. During that time, since we want to, you want to get really real?
Yeah.
All right. So during that time, and I don't tell this story much. Well, I haven't told this story much. It's in my book. So I had an off and on girlfriend at that point, and she was well known in the model world. Our moms were best friends.
Okay.
And so our families were really close. Our moms grew up together, and it was kind of like the match made in heaven for our parents. Like, I'm in NFL. She's, you know, a model, you know, mm-hmm. a top model.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, let's bring them together, pretty much. And so she was in New York, and I was in Indy, and, you know, we had a kind of off and on relationship. And while I was in Indy, I'll just be honest, I was living a life, you know. I made up excuses. Oh, she's probably doing her thing and stuff like that, even though I don't know if that was true or not, but it was an excuse for me to do the things I was doing, and didn't make me feel bad about it. And so I was partying, and I met someone who, well, she's not my wife, but I met Maria, and Maria had no idea. And you know, me and Maria, we were attracted to each other and messing around. And Maria ended up getting pregnant.
No, oh, wow.
Yeah, so I had a girlfriend at the time.
Yeah.
So that was really hard, because now I have to finally face the truth that in life, well, now I have to finally face the truth and I can't run from it. Like, there's no running from this.
Yeah.
There's no hiding this. It's right. Going
to
show.
Why did you feel the need to hide, first of all? Because you weren't married to your model girlfriend.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like, oh God, I'm trapped.
Yeah.
So I do want to ask mindset, no judgment whatsoever.
Yeah, for sure.
Just asking, why did you feel, if you were attracted to Maria so much and you've got your other girlfriend who's not even around,
right?
Why did you feel the need to not break it and just be like, okay, well, I'm attracted to you. Let me break up with my girlfriend.
Because me and Maria, it wasn't serious. You know, like, me and Maria wasn't serious like that. And it was just like, I don't know, you know. That's a great question. I think that I was maybe afraid to lose the relationship and maybe hurt some people in our family, maybe, but or even just to lose the significance of it. I don't know, you know. It was like the match made in heaven to everybody.
Well, it makes sense to me, because I'm on the outside looking in, right?
Yeah.
Like, the first thing that comes to my mind is you would disappoint your mom.
Exactly.
And then you would disappoint her friend.
Exactly.
Because they were like, oh my God, they're together. This is awesome. So not to disappoint them, now you're living a lie, and now you're having another relationship, and then this happens.
Yeah, and I'll just be real, a few. Like, I was living the life. Like, I was living the, I'm not going to say all athletes, because that's not right. It's a lot of great athletes.
Yeah.
But young guys, you know, you're introduced to this world where, like I said, the things you look up to, the models you see, like, you see, and it's like, like I said, growing up, that was success, mm-hmm. you know, in my mm-hmm. life. And so, yeah, I had to finally face that. And it was tough, because I became, I'm not that person, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, hurting people, it hurts me.
Yeah.
And it's crazy, because a lot of times in life, we think that if we hide it from a person, we're protecting them. But really, you're not, because eventually the truth is going to come out. They're going to be hurt even worse. Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Especially in this situation. So I became a really bad person to Maria. I blamed her when it wasn't her fault at all. And then, of course, my mom found out. Her mom found out. They became very angry at each other, the mothers. They weren't friends no more.
Oh, wow.
So it was bad. At that point in my life, it was very, 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 very tough, because it was like, this is going on. I'm not signed. This is after the season now. It's like 2008. I'm not signed. And, you know, I have a girl pregnant that, because I'm a pastor's son too.
Yeah,
so
I was going to say, you are the preacher's son.
So it's out of wedlock. Yeah. It's like, I don't even know, I know her, but I don't, you know her like that. And it's just like, man, like, this is how I envision, you know, my life going right now. And I wasn't being a man, you know. I wasn't super present for Maria's pregnancy, you know, looking back. And I just kept running. You know, I ran to other things again to mask it. It came to a point, I would say, when, you know, as Tristan started to, you know, as Marie started to get towards September, Tristan was about to be born. And I just started to reflect and realize, like, I have no excuse to be like this. Like, my dad was in my life my whole entire life. My parents have been married. Like, what are you doing with yourself? And I had the realization that I'm about to have a son. And whether this was planned or not planned, Tristan is going to follow my footsteps. And so I reached out to Maria, and we, you know, we got on good terms as far as, like, listen, I apologized. And when Tristan came out, it's like immediately my life changed. Mm. First time I seen Tristan, the first thing that I told my son in my head was, I don't want you to grow up to be like me.
Oh, wow.
And that hurt. You know, as a father, I mean, anybody's listening to this, if you got to tell someone, anybody, not to grow up to be like you or to be like you, it's like, you got to look at your life and say, like, what life am I leading? And immediately, I wanted to make some changes. And in the midst of all that, I'm still, you know, going from team to team, an unsure career. I'm with the Seattle Seahawks now. And, you know, that life is crazy. I mean, you know, I can just paint this picture. I know I'm jumping around a lot, but I'm just trying to paint as much as I can.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I was in Dallas because I got cut again. I got cut probably 8-9 times in my career. So I got
seriously
cut. Yeah, seriously.
That's a roller coaster.
And I only played for 3 teams. So it's them cutting me, bringing me back, cutting me, bringing me back. And just,
do you take responsibility for those cuts?
Yeah, I do. Yeah. I mean, when I was just talking inside, like, I do from a simple standpoint that I wasn't 100% focused. You know, even though I feel like I had the talent, I was making plays, but it's like, at the end of the day, I was 100% focused. You know, I wasn't locked in like I should have been locked in. It's funny, I feel like a lot of times with success that happens is like, you stop doing what got you there once you get there.
Yeah.
You know, it happens. And the same
it's
thing
like happens. You get there and it's like, oh yeah, well, I didn't think about it afterwards.
Yeah, it's like,
oh, I have to do something to stay here. Oh,
yeah,
I see.
I didn't have a plan to keep being my, you know, and it's just, not to just talk about dreams, but it's like, with our dreams, a lot of times our dreams is just to get there, right? It's not to stay there. It's not to, for something bigger than that. And so my dream was just to get there. So I was like, okay, I made it. I'm good, you know?
Yeah.
And so.
That's a great point.
I'm in Seattle. Well, I get cut. I'm in Dallas. And Seattle calls me. Like, Dallas and Fort Worth, I don't know if you've ever been out there. It's like,
yes.
It's like a 45 minute. It's like two different cities. So I'm in Dallas. I live in Fort Worth. They call me. It's like, hey, Trent, like, we want to bring you back. Like, we want you to come, like, tonight, like, today. And it was probably, like, 3 o'clock, 2 o'clock p.m. They want me to get, like, on a late night flight, like a 10 o'clock flight. I'm like, hey, can I just come tomorrow morning? He's like, no, I'll come now. Like, we want you now. Tomorrow, we got to get, you know, you fit in all that stuff. All right, cool. So I put down my phone. I mean, I hang up the phone. I speed back home. I'm, like, on Facebook. Hey, I'm going back to Seattle, man. Like, that's what's up. I'm telling everybody. And I pack my bags and I had everything. So I head to the airport. I'm at the airport. I get a call from a 206 number. And I'm like, hello? It's like, have you, I can laugh now, but it's like, have you left yet? And I was like, no. And it's like, never, like, we changed your mind. Don't come.
Oh my God.
So.
And you've already posted on Facebook.
Everything. So like.
So I think probably you're going to advise people not to do
yeah,
that.
Just like wait till like, it's like for sure.
Yeah, legit.
So yeah. And I just, at that point, you know, I was changing, but that's when I really got fed up with just like life. Even though Tristan was there, he was, you know, a few months old, but I'm just like, dang. And I lost the love for the game in that moment. I'm like, I'm tired of this, like, whatever. A few weeks later, they end up bringing me back, and I stay up there and finish out the season. They obviously cut me. And it was in 2009 when the change happened, the shift happened in my life. And I wish I could tell a story that it was some magical moment, but it really wasn't. It was March, I don't know the exact date, but 2009, and I don't have a job. I'm unsure about my life. People are telling me, you know, you should do this, you should do that, you should get a 9-to-5, and I'm highly considering it. And I remember being in my room. I'm looking around my room, and I'm seeing, like, all my trophies and pictures of my son and just college helmets, like, just memorabilia. And I'm just like, man, is this, like, really it? Like, is this really life? And I just broke down. Like, and I looked at myself in the mirror, and I looked at how I was living. I mean, literally, I was going out Monday through Monday, like, every night, you know, in the city. And I said, you know what? It's rehab time. And I said, it's time for you to rehab your life. This is not who you are. It's not who you were created to be. And I said, well, what can I control? And I figured three things out. I said, well, from a faith standpoint, I can control that. I need to build my faith on a deeper level, get closer to God. From a fitness standpoint, I said, I can control that. Let me take my body to a level it's never been before. And from a mindset standpoint, because I hate it, I didn't read books or nothing like that. I said, let me start reading books. Because in order to grow, you got to obtain knowledge that you don't have, right?
Yeah.
So I started doing the boring part of reading books, which isn't boring once you dive into it.
Right.
And that's what started Rehab Time. Rehab Time wasn't to be a speaker. It wasn't to be none of this. It was really just to save myself and my life. And the word rehab is literally, from my standpoint, it was putting strength back into a weakness. So those words meant, okay, Trent, it's rehab time. It's time to go. When I go to the gym, it's rehab time. Let's get it. It was for myself. Nobody knew about this at all. And
you didn't go on Facebook and post.
Not at all. Like, I didn't tell anybody because, you know, I didn't want to be like, I had like my group of friends, like, this wasn't the cool thing to do.
Yeah.
You know, like reading books and stuff like that. Like,
did you change your friends?
Oh, yeah.
No,
yeah.
But then when you were doing rehab.
Yep. Yes, I did.
That's important.
I did, big time. And that's why probably my biggest content is over, you know, like my biggest video is everybody isn't your friend. And it comes from a real place. So, yeah, I had to remove things from my life. And so I evaluated that. I was like, you know, there's certain people I cannot be around anymore. Not because they're bad people. It's just that if I want to grow my life.
Oh, there's
yeah,
those,
shout out to the sirens.
Yeah. Remember I told you guys you would hear that? There they are. It's real.
If I wanted to grow my life and push my life forward, I can't be around people that's keeping me in the same place.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not strong enough to, I had to face this because sometimes we think we're strong enough to say no. I knew I wasn't strong enough, so I couldn't be in that environment because I knew if I was in that environment, I was going to cave to that environment. Like, that was my addiction, right? So I was like, I got to get out of this environment. I got to change my habits. I changed my friends. I changed everything, and I literally went to work on myself. And at that was my last opportunity because NFL stands for not for long, so you have 3 years to prove yourself. So that was my last year to prove myself. And it's funny how, like, life will use something you care about to push you to something else. So I had one more tryout, and that was kind of like the rehab time thing for me. I was like, I'm going to get ready for this tryout. I'm going to be spiritually, mentally, physically fit. Go out there. I ran the fastest time of my life, a 4.340. The Redskins signed me. But then the whole thing repeats again. But now, when I got cut, it didn't hurt.
Because you knew you did everything.
I knew I did everything, and I knew that there was something more to my life now.
That's why it hurt before, because you knew.
Yeah.
That you did not put everything in there. So even though you probably wanted to blame everybody, you knew down deep inside, damn it, I lost this opportunity.
That's right. That's definitely right. I didn't care about it like I should have cared about. So I can't complain what happens. If you don't put your all into it, don't complain about what you get.
Yeah.
And, so that was my last stint at the NFL. But, of course, my identity was wrapped in that, so I didn't want to let go. So I'm trying to play arena football now. Mm. And it's just crazy how every door will shut when it's not meant for your life. Like, they had a league that came out. It's called the UFL, and it's not around no more, obviously. But it was like a JV type of, like a minor league to the NFL. And I went out there, and my college coach was one of the coaches. I ran out there in a fast time. They signed me. So I'm like, cool. I'm finally like, this is going to be my opportunity to get back to the NFL. Two weeks later, the league folds. Like, it collapses. So I'm just like, I cannot catch a break.
Yeah.
You know, so then I go to arena football, which I hate it.
Why?
I mean, it's just terrible. I mean, you know, no offense to anybody who plays arena. You got to really love the game. But it's fun. But, like, it's turf with concrete under it. There's walls around. It's like WWE almost, you know. there's walls around. Like, if you go over the wall, there's concrete, you know, everything. So I'm just like, my body, this isn't fun, you know. It's like the game is kind of fun, but it hurts. Like, you into the stands, and just to be real, like, you're getting paid nothing. I mean, I could probably work a 9-to-5, regular 9-to-5, and get paid more than that.
Oh, wow.
But I was doing it not because I love football. Because I didn't love football no more at that point in my life. I was doing it because my identity was wrapped in that. Who would I be? How would I pay my bills? I've been Trent Shelton, the football player, since I was 5 years old. How do I redefine myself? Like, who am I? So let me just keep doing this as if football's not going to be over anyway.
This is Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
So I have a question for you. Any of you feeling tired, stressed, anxious, depressed? Do you want to have an overall sense of well-being? Wouldn't that be amazing? Well, I'm here to tell you all about CBD. You know, CBD is getting more and more press every single day, and that's because of all the life-changing ways that it is impacting your life and your health. And so I want to tell you about Cured Nutrition, because they are one of the people that are bringing the show to you for absolutely free. And I appreciate Cured Nutrition because they're also an incredible product. They're organic, hemp-derived CBD products. They have nibbles, tinctures, treats, and they all work with your body's natural endocannabinoid system to produce clear benefits without the worry of the psychoactive component. Plus, how many other companies can say that they've been thriving with an in-house farm-to-table business model? And CBD is most commonly incorporated into wellness regimens to improve sleep, decrease inflammation, and also reduce the body's stress load. So overall, it is going to help you, and it also can help your pet. I have brought this up before. You can put the full spectrum raw oil. You can put it in your pet's food if they actually suffer from anxiety, or if they're getting, you know, like supporting their recovery after a seizure. So that's really good for them to have something for the little ones. I absolutely love the spices. Let me tell you about the spices. Seriously. It is peanut butter chocolate, cinnamon and honey, blackening seasoning, smoky barbecue, the roasted garlic and lemon pepper. Like, you just put this on your food, like when you're cooking, and it's got CBD in there. So it's going to help your endocannabinoid system. It's going to help your immune system. I need more of that now than ever since I'm sick. So definitely give it a try. CuredNutrition.com/glory. And use the promo code GLORY for 15% off your entire order. So that's curednutrition.com/glory. Hey, and if you're worried about jumping through hoops to get your hands on your own Cured Nutrition products, don't be, because the company will ship your products to all 50 states. So you can find your favorite products, any of them, like even the chocolate cookie dough. Did I tell you about that chocolate cookie dough, how delicious it is? It is absolutely phenomenal. So try it out. You're going to love it because, like I said, it's going to help you with your stress load, with your anxiety, with your depression. Try this before you go down that rabbit hole of feeling so bad day after day, day after day, and day after day. Give it a shot. You'll see how CBD is going to help just balance your body. That's what CBD does. All right, so curednutrition.com/glory and use the promo code GLORY for 15% off. All right, and Chasing Glory is also brought to you by Skillshare. Skillshare is an online learning community for creators with more than 25,000 classes in design, business, and more. You're going to discover countless ways to fuel your curiosity, your creativity, and your career. So this could be for your new career, or it could be like a side project. So you can take classes in social media, in marketing, in mobile photography, how about creative writing, how about game design, animation, web development, you name it, they have it. Whether you're looking to discover a new passion or start a side hustle, or you gain some new professional skills, Skillshare is there to keep you learning, thriving, and reaching those new goals. Remember what I always tell you guys, if you're not growing, you're decaying. So keep learning, keep that brain functioning. Just be a sponge, and you'll see maybe there's something in there that all of a sudden it triggers you and you're like, whoa, this has been my passion. Because there's some people out there that don't even have a passion. They don't know yet what it is that they want out of life. And so I'm speaking to you. Go to Skillshare.com, scroll through all those options. There's over 25,000 classes. So you can scroll through all that, and all of a sudden you can go, wait, that kind of interests me. And then once you dive in there and take the class, you're going to be blown away. All of a sudden, you're going to be like, voila, this is what I was made to do. So join the millions of students already learning on Skillshare today with a special offer just for my listeners. Get 2 months of Skillshare for free. How'd you like that? That's right. Skillshare is offering Chasing Glory listeners 2 months of unlimited access to over 25,000 classes for free. So sign up today. Go to Skillshare.com/glory. Again, that's Skillshare.com/glory to start your 2 months now. Skillshare.com/glory. All right, now back to the show.
Now more Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
Do you remember when you stopped playing, the moment that you were like, what do I do with the rest of my life because my identity is wrapped so much around this? Because a lot of other athletes, let's say WWE superstars, right?
Yeah.
It comes to an end.
It does.
And they don't know what to do. But that's also singers. That's also other, you know, dancers
yep.
that lose the ability to dance anymore. They have hip replacements or whatever. And their identity is wrapped up in that. Do you remember that moment? And how did you get to transfer to
yeah.
something else?
I do. I was lucky because the moment... So I didn't, like, stop playing and then the moment was created. I stopped playing because of the moment, right?
Oh, okay.
So I was still trying to play arena. I was supposed to go to... I signed with New Orleans Voodoo. And my mom, like... She's like, I don't want you going back to New Orleans. And I don't know. She has a thing with New Orleans. So she's
yeah.
like, I don't want you going back there. But she's like, I just hope that you don't. And I was like, well, I'm going because I have nothing else. I have a son that I got to take care of and I got to figure some stuff out. So throughout this process, though, in college and with the Redskins, I have a friend who his dad is Dr. Tony Evans, which is a big time mega pastor. His sisters and brothers are just great. Their whole family is incredible. And Jonathan was pretty much my mentor, you know, and he would always just speak into my life and just be like, man, you know, there's more inside you than you think. And, you know, I'm around these, like, you have a gift. And I wasn't trying to hear none of that. And he got me to go on stage. I was actually supposed to be in New Orleans that day, but I convinced my coach, like, hey, let me come Friday. I had this big speaking engagement to kids, and I'll just come down there Friday. So, or Saturday, my bad. So that Friday, I go to do this speaking engagement that I didn't want to do. I was convinced to do from my friend, like, I'm talking about like a thorough process of 30 minutes of going back and forth. I didn't want to do it. Speaking was my biggest fear. All these things. Make a long story short, I get on that stage and I can't explain it, but the best way I can explain it is I just never felt a feeling of this was what I was created to do.
Wow.
And I literally got off the stage. I called my coach. I said, I'm not coming to New Orleans. I called.
Oh, yeah. You literally didn't even know.
No, I didn't go.
Wow.
I didn't go.
A shift.
Big time.
That is a huge shift because I can imagine you going, wow, this is cool, but let me just go. You just like right then and
there.
I said, I'm not doing it
because I knew if I went, it would continue the cycle of trying to continue to play ball. I knew I had to like cut it off cold turkey. So I said, I'm not coming. He like, and these calls were the most, like, not motivating calls to make a change with your life. I mean, he hung up in my face.
But you know what I love? Well, they didn't cut you ever, right?
No, they didn't.
But you actually got to, even though he didn't cut you before, I mean, out of 8 or 9 times, you got to make that
call. Yeah, I got, yeah, exactly. It was like the ball was in my court for sure.
How good did that feel?
It felt
right?
good. It felt good, but it was scary because sure. I wasn't sure if I was making the right decision. I'm like, I have, like, that's, I mean, even though it wasn't much, but that's how I was paying, you know, my bills and, you know, helping, you know, with my child at that moment. And it's like, I want people to understand, like, rehab time was kind of a thing. Like, I was making videos here and there, but it was like, I say rehabish. Like, I wasn't all the way, like, rehab time. It was 1 foot, 1 foot out. So I had no following, pretty much none of that. So the second
No money coming in. None of that. And right now, the only reason I want to stop you is because that's where a lot of people are in their lives, is the fact that they have found something new, but now they're scared to let go of the security,
yeah.
of the known money, of the known this. This is so the fear of the unknown becomes so much bigger than what they do know, even though they're so unhappy
yeah.
or things aren't that great. So, yeah, please take us to what made you go, I'm doing it anyway.
Well, I just looking back too, like fulfillment to me is the greatest, like, riches you could have. Like, fulfillment is everything. And so if somebody's out there like, hey, I have no money to do this, I'm worried about this. Like, but if it fulfills you, like, there's nothing better than fulfillment because there's people, I was that person, like had the world, but I had no fulfillment, you know, and I had all yeah. the money and all this stuff. So fulfillment is what you want. And I had that feeling of fulfillment. So I called my friends. It was like the second group of calls, some friends that, and like, they were like tripping, like, what? Like, you don't do what? Nah. And I had some friends that were kind of supportive, but they didn't really get the vision.
Yeah.
That's another thing too. I want people to understand, like, everybody's not, probably nobody's going to see your vision. Like, you're going to see it. That's why it's your vision.
Yeah.
So I called my mom and my dad. And I just knew they were going to be super, super. Well, I called my mom and I was hoping that my dad answered because my dad is kind of the easier one to talk to.
Yeah.
My mom picks up the phone and I have a conversation with her, and it's so funny because she didn't try to talk me out of it. She was just talking to me out of protection. Like, are you sure? Like, and I was like, Mom, and I just told her, I was like, man, I've never felt so much like security and power in the midst of like, what was my biggest fear? And she was like, you know what? Go do it. And I kid you not, when I made that decision, I know it's not going to work out for everybody like this, but when I really let go of what I was holding on to that I knew I need to let go of, probably within the next, I'll just say half a year, videos, I started to make videos. Mm-hmm. And those videos started to go viral. And what people know as rehab time started there. Like within a half a year of me making a decision to let go of this.
Yeah.
My life changed. And I wasn't getting money and stuff like that. I mean, I was speaking for free, which I wanted to do, and just to, you know, get my message out. But I was able to, at that time, I took a job at 24 Hour Fitness.
I was just going to say, how did you sustain yourself?
I took a job at 24 Hour Fitness, which was very hard for me. Because
NFL player to 24 Hour Fitness.
Exactly.
Wow.
Exactly.
But that says a lot about you, too. And I think that's a lot of people get so caught up in, well, I can't do that if I've been here.
Exactly.
But you thought the bigger vision. You were like, well, you humbled yourself.
There you go. That's the magic word. I had to humble myself, and it was the best decision that I made, because even from as a speaker, like, I'm getting to train, like, I did group classes. So I'm training and speaking and motivating every night. So I'm getting practice.
There you go.
And also, I probably shouldn't have been doing this, but I had, at that time, I started creating shirts, and I got in trouble. They made me sell them outside the club, but people were coming to me like, I want that shirt. And so I built this culture inside of 24 where my classes, like, they would sell out. It was like 100 people in a room.
Wow.
And it started to grow, and people started to, like, rehab time, and it started to catch momentum. And it was just crazy, like, how it worked out. But it took me willing to be embarrassed. It took me willing to, like you said, humble myself and say, you know what? Of course people made fun. I was working at 24 Hour Fitness. Like, people were saying that I would hear, like, you working here, you know, blah, 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 this or that.
Fall from grace.
Exactly.
Right? Oh, that fall from grace.
But it was the best decision I ever made, because it built up community. It also built me up my confidence as a trainer, as a speaker, as a coach. And that transition, it sustained me money. Even though I still wasn't getting a lot of money, it sustained me to be able to provide. And luckily, I had a blessed, by that time, Maria was my girlfriend. And instead of her kicking me while I'm down, instead of me, you know, throwing, even when I was just her baby daddy, she wasn't belittling me or saying, oh, you can't provide. Like, she believed in me. Mm-hmm. Even when she could have been like, she had every opportunity not to, or to belittle me, but she uplifted me. And she held it down for so long while I pursued this vision of rehab time. And yeah, I mean, the rest is history. And I had to get to a point, because people always ask, like, how do you know when to leave a job? I said, literally, 24 Hour Fitness fired me because I couldn't be at classes because I was getting now requested to speak places.
Oh, wow. There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah. So became. Do you wish that you would have left on your own terms at 24 Hour Fitness? Like, you would have gone ahead and let that go?
Kind of. But it's funny. Like, not to this 24 Hour Fitness or anything, but it's funny because it's like they fired me because I wasn't there. But I told them, I was like, hey, like, I could be a, like, I can kind of be a sub anytime y'all need me, because I can't commit to these days because my life is just. It's just crazy.
Let him know. It's not like you didn't
show
up anymore.
But they fired me. They fired me because of that. Wow. And it's funny because I'm like, okay, cool, y'all fired me. And I guess they got caught wind. I don't know if it's the corporate or whoever caught wind of who I was at that time, because my social media started to grow. And they called me. I said, you know, this is not fair that you treat somebody like this. Like, you know, it's just not fair. And so they found out who I was. And then they hit me back. It was like, no, we want you back. And this or that. And I was like, no, I'm good. I'm good.
Wow.
I'm good.
They got nervous.
Exactly. I was like, no, I'm good. And I would never talk bad. I was like, I'm good. Because, I mean, it had to come to a point where I had to stop that anyway.
Yeah.
And, yeah, and that's when, like, rehab time really started.
But, you know, sometimes, and you're a man of faith, God gives you that push out the door.
Exactly.
That you're not willing to do yourself.
Big time. You definitely close doors that you don't have the strength or courage to close on your own. God will definitely do that. I mean, you see that with my whole NFL career.
Yeah. You know? Do you watch football at all and miss it in any?
That's a great question. So for a while, I didn't.
You couldn't watch it.
I couldn't watch it.
Yeah.
because it brought up, you know, those emotions. And for a while, I was protecting my son from injury and all that stuff. But really, I didn't want him playing because I still had that bitterness in my heart for the game.
Yeah.
And that really struck with me when I was like, man, I'm holding my son back because of things that I haven't healed from the sport. And that wasn't fair to him. And so, you know, I said, there's something bigger to my life. And at that point, I started to realize, like, football wasn't it. And I just developed other things to keep me competitive. Like, I would play flag football. I would play intramural basketball. Because as an athlete, you know, you got to have that. You're a competitor, you know. Yeah. So I wanted to have that competitive nature.
Yeah.
But I realized everything I learned with football, I could apply to what I do now. And those same exact skills. Like, as an athlete, the skills that you learn is, like, second to none. So I tell all athletes, like, when your sport is over, your life is really just beginning. Like, you have an advantage on a lot of people.
Yeah. Because mindset, the discipline, all of that.
Big
sure.
time. And, yeah. And so I had to really come to grips with that. And, like, I was like, man, I can't let this control me. And I just started watching, let Tristan start playing football. And I find healing, and I coach it and everything now.
So he plays?
Yeah, he plays now. Yeah. I coach his team. Yep.
Yeah. I bet that's fun, and that's fulfilling.
Oh, yeah, big time. It's fun. And to see him, you know, grow and fulfill, and other kids, like, I love it. You know, I love the game. I love sports in general, coaches, basketball team, and everything. I love being around it.
Yeah. I bet it's hard, though, you know, making that decision or realizing that you needed to make that shift. I'm sure sometimes you get that question, am I really, who am I? Because here's the thing that I battle with. Sometimes, and I've said it myself.
Yeah.
If you want something, go after it. Don't take no for an answer. Go for it. You want it, you got it. Like, I used to say that a lot. Now I've kind of been like, why don't you stay open? Stay open a lot. Because sometimes you're going to think you want this when actually this is the direction you should take. Like, the universe, God, whatever you believe in is going to take you in this direction. Just be open. I never saw myself as a ring announcer for the WWE. Like, that is not something that I, as 5-year-old Lil, watching WWE with my dad, you know, because I did I sit there and look at the TV and, Dad, one day I want to be that. No. But when the opportunity came, I was like, huh, let me just see.
Yeah.
You know? I always wanted to be a singer. Like, that was my thing. Sing. Now, I got to sing within the WWE, so that was cool. I got to incorporate it. But it never didn't look exactly like I pictured. So I struggled a little bit I was supposed to be like Gaga or Katy Perry or, you know, full-time singing.
Right.
So I struggled with the part-time, as I called it. So that's one thing I try to tell people. Though, it trying to find that. Everyone has their own.
Yeah.
What would you say to somebody, for example, me, who I saw myself going this, but I only did it part-time, and I ring announced, you know, and sang the national anthem. It was fulfilling. But I wanted more. And it just, that door didn't necessarily open. What would you tell me to be able to appreciate more? The path didn't look exactly the what I thought it was going to be.
Well, the path was exactly what it needed to be. And I always say purpose is bigger than you, right? You just never know who you affected, right, by being in that ring. Like, as a singer, yeah, you might have made whatever, but you might not have affected someone's life that was watching and say, you know what, she gives me confidence, you know, or whatever it may be. And sometimes you will never know that, who you affect. And so it's the same thing with my life. It's like, yeah, football for me was like the pinnacle, but if I wasn't doing this, I wouldn't be making an impact on millions of people's lives.
Yeah.
That wasn't happening in football.
Yeah.
So the thing that I tell people that they don't like when I say it, and every time I speak to a crowd, they get kind of quiet, is like, sometimes your dreams aren't what you're created to do. And a lot of people don't understand that. So sometimes it takes letting go of what you want to do and grabbing a hold on what you are called to do. And that is a very tough battle, but you will find more fulfillment. Your calling is bigger than you. Your calling is, I feel like, even the word purpose, right? Like, there's a connection that I can't really explain that happens when you live in your calling that goes beyond you, right? And so if your dreams are failing, just know your life, like, isn't over. Like, it's okay. Like, It's what you want to do, cool. But there are other things with your life. So don't think your life is over because of that. And I'm a living witness to that. I mean, everything I ever wanted that doesn't matter to me now, I have times 10 now in living in my calling.
So do you still tell people if they have a passion and a dream, go for it?
Yeah, I'll tell them. I mean, because I know that's what drives them, but I think that's part of the journey. I think in doing that, you know, I try to teach people, you know, stay open, of course, but I know most people, you have a dream and that's what you want to go to. Like my son, his dream is to go to the NFL. I'm like, all right, cool. That's what you want to hit? Let's do it. Because I know on the journey, that's going to teach him certain things. So I feel like...
And who knows? His path might be to be Tom Brady.
It might. Exactly. It might.
You never know.
Exactly. And that's why it's hard to tell people, like, what not to do, what to do, is just to understand this. You are not what you do. You are not your job. You are not your... Even your dream. This is crazy to say. Like, you are who you are. And so when you understand that, I just try to let people know, this is going to come to an end probably. Whether it's, say, football. Whether it's Tom Brady's going to retire.
Yeah.
He's going to have to figure something else out.
Yeah.
You know? He is. How great as he was. And what are you going to do when you lose that? And so the thing I just try to really instill in people is, like, when you lose it, don't lose yourself.
Yeah.
And so your sport is what you do. It's not who you are. Mm-hmm. Your job is what you do. It's not who you are. Even your dream is not who you are. So figure out who you are. And listen, these are vehicles that will lead you to different places. If it wasn't for the NFL, I can tell you, I wouldn't be here.
Yeah.
You know, I wouldn't be, because it led me here. So it's all a part of the process.
Even the struggle, because you going through the struggle, you can also empathize for other people that have lost the weight, been cut, said no to multiple times. Having to find a different path, all of this, you can empathize with all of it, and now you can speak to it.
Those are, I mean, it's the best way to educate people, I feel like, is through experience.
Yeah.
It is. I mean, you know, I always use this analogy. It's like if you were to, say, go on a hike, and I talked about it today, if you were to go on a hike and you were asking me, like, hey, like, Trent, like, how do you get to whatever, the pinnacle of the hike? And I'm just like, I never hiked it before, but here's a map. You know, here's a map that I made. I never hiked it. I just kind of figured maybe this is how you might do it. You look at me like I was crazy. You'd be like, oh, I'm not taking this advice. But if I said, listen, I've been here before. Here's the map. This is exactly how you get through it. You'd be like, okay, cool. This guy can really help me. And so I use that analogy. It's the same way with life. Like, you going through what you went through qualifies you to help other people get through it. And so it changed your mindset, your perspective towards pain. I'm not saying to put yourself through pain or to stay in pain, but now, since you were in that bad relationship and you experienced that and you got over that, you got through that, you can now help somebody else that's going through that bad relationship. So it qualifies you as an expert to help people. So every time I go through pain, even now, I'm like, this is my power. I was like, this is bigger than me, and it's going to help. My present pain or my past pain will be someone else's future strength. That's how I look at it.
Wow. You being, is it the preacher's son and pastor's son? Is it the same
Either,
thing?
Yeah, same yeah, thing, pretty same much.
Thing. Yeah. You know, sometimes there's such a pressure when you are that.
Yeah.
To be perfect, right?
Yep.
How was that pressure for you growing up?
It was tough. Well, it was tough, but my brothers made it easy because they weren't perfect.
so they led the way with it. You're good.
Well, maybe I'll make it like a little bit more pressure. Like, one of you guys got to be it. Like, so Trent, you have to be it. So it wasn't that bad. I mean, we never wanted to disappoint our parents, right? But my dad is so chilled and cool. He wasn't the parent, the pastor that's like, you know, because he came from a real place. You know what I'm saying? My dad has always kept it real with us. And, you know, he wasn't the, like... But we never wanted to disappoint our parents, too. So it's like we knew if we were doing something wrong and, you know, people were going to come to them and talk. And then my mom's going to hear that. And we never wanted to put that pressure on them. So it was tough, you know, just trying to fit the mold of, you know, the perfect Christian boy. It was very hard. And I think that's when it came to a point where I was like, forget this, and just rebelled against it. Like, I'm going to do the exact opposite. And a lot of people do that.
Yeah, they do. That's why I wanted to ask you that, because they do the opposite. But you have found your way to God.
Yeah, for sure.
And he's a big part of your life.
Everything, yes.
So how did you find that? back with him because you were rebelling.
So it was instilled. I always say, like, God was like a part of my life. Like, you know, he wasn't my everything. It was just like I prayed because that was what I was supposed to do. Or like I called on God when times got hard. And so as I grew in high school and college, you know, it became, he became further and further away from me. It became more of like, okay, when I need God, or just came like a, like I'll go to church just for an attendance check mark, as if that matters. It was when I hit my rock bottom. It was the NFL, losing all of that. And rock bottom literally made like God the rock of my life. I had nothing else. Not because people weren't there, but I was such a man, which is, you know, how men are. And you, men shouldn't be like this. You should be open. But I was such like in that stigma of like, oh, I'm a man, like I got this. And so people couldn't help me because I wouldn't allow them to help me. Mm. You know, I'm like, I'm good. This is, I'm not worried about that.
Face.
Yeah.
You put the Instagram face.
Exactly.
Everything's perfect.
The filter life for sure.
Yeah.
And I just committed and I was like, man, like I want to make you, I want you to lead my life. And I'm willing to go wherever you take me, like wherever that is. And he took me to a place that I didn't want to go to. Like I tell people, I didn't want to go to that stage to be a speaker. You know, even as I did it the first few years, I still contemplated a lot about like, is this really what I want to do? And I just said, you know what? I'm gonna allow you to lead my life and wherever you take me, because I owe you so much. I feel like that I'm just gonna serve you and do it in my way, like lead people closer to you in my way. And I'm not gonna be in a pulpit. I'm not gonna be preachy all the time. I'm just going to try to show people through my life that, you know, God is my foundation. And it's crazy because I've seen so many people come to me and say, oh, man, you led me closer to God. And I was like, how? And it's just like, just by your lifestyle, like you live it, you know, it's not like you just
even the reminder, I think sometimes too.
Yeah.
Because I think we get so caught up in this lifestyle and it's filtered and we're so busy, doing that we like, well, we don't have time for church, or we forget, or, you know, whatever, that sometimes hearing your message, all of a sudden it's like, oh, yeah, God can be there for me.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I had a friend of mine at WWE when I was going through a really hard time, Molly Holly. She had said to me, I was going through therapy and all, and she said, you know, therapy's great and all, but don't forget, God's there for you. And I looked at her and I went, totally forgot.
Yeah.
And I grew up Catholic.
Yeah.
Grew up going to church and just totally forgot. And then when I realized that and I started reaching out to him, felt good. Now, there's some people that will listen to this and are so turned off by religion.
Right.
Can become completely atheist. Like you said, you got turned off for a while. I always say if somebody's atheist, I don't try to turn them. I'm like, that's their journey. You know, whatever.
Right.
What about you if somebody's atheist that you know?
Same thing. You know, my job is to plant seeds, and I've seen it work so many times where I've had people, especially now, like that, you know, or even they just say like, I didn't believe in God at all. And so I'm not trying to send you to a hell or a heaven. I'm just trying to share my faith in a non-pushy way.
Yeah.
And however you choose to live your life, you know, that's your life. But I have to stay, you know, true to who I am. And even when I speak on stages, like, that's what I tell people, like, you know what you get from me. Like, I'm not going to hide my faith I'm not going to be preachy, but I have to talk about God in my journey at some point because he was a big part of my journey.
That's what I was going to ask you, because here we are, we're going to go into Powerful You.
Right? Yeah.
And I'm really excited about this. When I found out that you were going to be part of it and I saw you, we were filming for the movie, which was so exciting to be part of.
For sure.
And I'm sitting here watching you do your thing. I was like, oh my God, this guy's going to hit the stage and just going to be incredible. But, you know, Powerful You tries to be one that's all encompassing. It doesn't try to alienate anyone and just kind of high. It goes deep.
Right.
Goes deep. But kind of not, let's not pick a faith. Let's not, you know, go there. Let's try to speak to the masses. So how do you be you on stage with something like that?
Well, I think it just shines. I've always, you know, John Maxwell, he's become a good friend of mine, and I asked him that because John Maxwell, I mean, he used to be a pastor, you know, a lot of people don't know that, you know. And it's just like, he told me, he said, my job is not to, what he said, convert people when I first meet them, but if they want to come into my world, then they'll see what my world is about. And mine is the same thing. Like, I'm not, you know, I probably will mention God, you know, in my story, but I'm not going to sit there and preach. But I think you can feel it. It's a certain type of energy. And as you dive in deeper, say, oh, I want to know about Trent's story more, then that introduction is there. You know, I always respect people's environments, you know, like, because I know too, like, there was a point in my life where I didn't want to be preached to. Like, I don't want to hear that because I'm not at that place in my life. So the best thing to do is to plant your seeds, live your story, and as people come into your house, your life, and ask you more questions, then you're able to give them more answers. Like, this is what happened for me. This is what I did, you know?
Yeah. Do you remember that first book? Because I want to actually touch on people that they're hearing this right now, which I really appreciate them taking the time to do this, right? That's already learning. That's already reaching for me. Like, the growth is listening to something like this, especially if maybe they don't even know who you are and they're taking the opportunity to get to know your story. Because I always feel like you can learn so much from each person. Somebody is in their life completely stuck. They're maybe overweight. They feel really bad about their situation of being overweight, of not having the job or the dream, even the desire. They don't even know how to get to that, pick up and start losing weight, maintain it, right? Get inspired enough, motivated, or anything like that. What would you say to people like that? I don't know if you remember the first book that got you going. Or imagine yourself
at the,
in that room. You're hiding from the world because you've been cut your first time.
Yep.
What did you do to get off and get going?
Understand that I was created enough. So the thing I would tell somebody that's in that position is I want you to look at the facts. Feelings, I always say facts over feelings. Feelings are real, but they aren't always right. Feelings will tell us that we're not enough or whatever based on emotion. But what are the facts about your life? The fact is that you are a miracle. And you say, well, how does that work? Well, there's a 0% chance of you becoming you. Just even by science, you know, that your mom meeting that the sperm meets the egg, like, it's crazy,
right?
Like crazy, crazy. So if you're looking for a miracle, you're that miracle. From a faith perspective, God has created you. Like, if you're in faith, think about that. Like, God created you, one you, and he set you apart. He tells in scripture, you're fearfully and wonderfully made. So believe that, you know, so you were created with worth. And the thing that I see so many people do, even myself at a point, is we allow the external, meaning the world, people, judgment, all these things to determine our worth, how they see
likes,
us,
how many likes
right? All those things control us. But no, you were created with worth. The creator gave you worth. So if the creator gave you worth, that's something that nobody can take away without your permission. And so a lot of times we give the permission for other people that are going through pain to put pain on us, right? For situations to control us. So I would just like sit back and realize that, like, for one, you are enough. Get that through your head. The second thing that I would tell people to do is to focus on one thing that you could change. Just one that's in your control. Because when we think about, when we get frustrated, when we get anxiety and all these things, we're always thinking about things that we probably can't control, that are out of control.
Yeah.
And that just makes us, like, more paralyzed. So what's something that you can control right now that will make a shift or a small change in your life? And go do it.
Yeah.
So for me, when I started rehab time, it was working out. I could control that. It was picking up my word and reading books. I could control that. And so there's nothing I can tell you to do if you're not going to be willing to put in some type of work.
Yeah,
right?
Something.
You have to say, I have to do something to make a change in my life.
Do you remember that first book that you picked up?
Yeah, it was Purpose Driven Life was the book that really changed me.
Oh, that's really good.
Yeah, by Rick Warren. That was the book that really, like, I was like, man, this got me.
Yeah.
Yep.
I have to bring something up because I heard you say this, and I had this aha last night, of all things. Mm-hmm. It's crazy. And then when I heard you talk about this earlier today, I was like, oh my God, this is exactly what I was going through. So you were saying that you didn't feel, or forgive me if I misconstrue exactly, but that you weren't celebrating your victories.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, for sure.
Remember talking about that, right? You weren't celebrating your victories. And the reason you weren't celebrating your victories is because you had two older brothers and you felt like they would be jealous. Mm-hmm. So you were like, oh, I'm just going to be super humble about this and super quiet. And I'm like, okay, I got this, right? My aha last night was the fact that I was struggling in my life sometimes just to be happy. Just be happy, Lil, at the things that you get, at your life in general. And a friend of mine said to me, she said, is it because you don't feel worthy? And I struggled with that for years. And I've really been studying about this, right? Trying to figure out, did I not feel worthy? And I'm like, no, I don't know what it is, but I have felt worthy of it. I've never not felt worthy, okay? So it wasn't until literally I was like, oh my Lord, my parents didn't have the best marriage at all, okay? So my mom was not happy with the marriage. Well, my dad, same thing. And then she was a housewife. She took care of us, and she always talked about how she wanted to work, but she didn't because of this. So all of my whole life, I started creating a story of, I can't tell her I'm happy in my marriage, because then she'll be sad, because then she'll be jealous, because I have the good marriage, she doesn't.
Right.
Same thing with, I can't tell her how great my job is going, because she wants to be working, and she didn't work, because she gave up her job to raise us, so therefore I don't want to rub it in her face. So when you said that today, I was just like, that's exactly what happened to me. And I felt free, though, to realize my whole thing was that I felt guilty. I felt guilty that I was happy in my marriage. I felt guilty that I was happy working. I felt guilty that I, you know, could be happy because she didn't have friends. I felt guilty that I was out with my friends having a good time. It's incredible the things that we realize. Do you remember when you realized that moment of the victories?
Yeah, it's called like success guilt. Like that's what it is. Like because
I never heard of it.
Yeah, I was like, this is success guilt. It's when it's almost like because they have survivor's guilt. You know, when you survive, like say you're in a crash and the other people didn't make it, you survived.
Oh, yeah.
So
yeah,
or like in war, right? It's called survivor's guilt. So I was like, this is success guilt. Is that? Because I felt that too, even with my friends. Like, I'm the one that's given the scholarship. They're not. Mm, you know, so I'm like, dang, I can't be.
I can't like, be like, oh,
yeah,
I
can't. You know, it's like, I'm the NFL and my friends, like, and even, like, it got to, even with, like, now, it's like, that still comes up at times, but I immediately, like defute that. Like, I celebrate. So, yeah, it actually was, I went to Tony's event, Tony Robbins' event, Day with Destiny, and that's when it was revealed to me because we're working through a process, and I'm like, "And where does this come from? Where like, because it just would be weird that I just couldn't feel like all like when people come up to me and say, Trent, like you changed my life, like I hear it, but I just couldn't feel it like how I should feel it, you know?
Yeah.
It just was like I became numb to it. I was like, where did this come from? So I started to work through it, and I started to realize like, man, like I don't want to celebrate like. No type of accomplishments. Like, I don't really, like, just really embrace it and feel it. Like, it's always just moving on to the next thing. Mm-hmm. And I was just asking, like, where did that come from? You know, why is a powerful question, guys. Like, just ask yourself why. You know, the seven layers deep process that a lot of people talk about. And I realized that it came from that. And so it was in that moment I said, you know what? My brothers never were jealous. My brothers are more happy for me. They always been than I am for myself. And like that's a story I was telling myself. My friends, listen, I can't control how they feel.
Right.
I mean, some are happy for me, some didn't like it, but I can't control that.
Right.
And so I told myself, like, the whole make the world respect your greatness, like that's like my celebration mode. Like 2019, I told myself I'm gonna be on that vibe of not being arrogant or being like the unattractive, like celebrate your life, like that's stepping on people, but I'm gonna really appreciate every single win that I have. So we hit a mark. We're having fun. My book is coming out. We're going to celebrate that thing.
Yeah.
You know, and I want to teach not just myself, but my family, my son, my daughter, like be proud of what you do, because if you're not proud of what you do, then you're going to get to your success and you're going to feel empty and you're going to get to a point where nothing fulfills you.
Yeah. And that's scary.
All.
That's a bad place to be, because I have felt that and certain things that I've accomplished that all of a sudden I just didn't want to celebrate. And you said it, making up stories, because my mom wanted me to be happy in my marriage. My mom wanted, she's just, even the other day when I told her something that I got and I was kind of hesitant, she's like, oh my God, I've been praying for this. I'm so happy for you. And I literally, when all of this came to my mind last night and I figured it all out, I went, I've been making up the longest story for so many years.
Exactly.
Oh, and that's why I wanted to talk about it, because if there's anybody out there right now that's going, well, I can't celebrate this because that's going to make that person jealous. Look, if it makes them jealous, it makes them jealous. Maybe it makes them also fire up to go and get it done.
That, and it has nothing to do with you. Like, that's what you have to understand. Like,
right.
If they feel a certain type of way about your success, just understand that it has nothing to do with you. It's something that they aren't doing in their own life, right? And you can't postpone your growth or your life to make other people feel comfortable. You can't silence your greatness to make other people feel comfortable. And so, like, yeah, I like let go of that, like, probably like 2 years ago. And I'm just like, man, I'm gonna celebrate everything, because then you fall in love with the celebration part of it. Like, you know, it just triggers you,
yeah,
you know, to want to win and just to have that celebration. So,
Yeah, because otherwise, man, life is long without a celebration.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh, great. I'm going to celebrate when I get to the grave. Like, what?
It's like scoring touchdowns. Like,
yes.
Even though because I thought about that. It's like, when I score a touchdown, like, what makes me, like, want to score? And the score, of course, you want to help your team. But it's like the feeling you get, the crowd goes crazy. You get to celebrate, like, just the energy. And it makes scoring touchdowns, like, that much more fun.
Yeah.
So it's like the same thing in life. Like, it makes it
dance.
That much more. Exactly. Exactly.
I love that. Do the dance. All right. My final question to you that I always love to get people's perspective. Has your chase for glory looked the way you thought it was going to look?
Absolutely not. A lot more detours than what I thought it would be like. But it was the perfect path for my life. Even though the path was imperfect, the purpose of the path was perfect.
That's beautiful. You're doing some tremendous things now. I hope it's fulfilling you even more than that touchdown would have fulfilled you.
Because
you're creating so many touchdowns now, like massive amounts every single day with the people that you're impacting.
Thank you.
I can't wait to hit the stage with you and
introduce
you.
Yes, it's going to be awesome. This is going to be awesome.
Yeah, if you guys are interested, Powerful You is going to be May 17th through the 19th. It's a three-day event. It is transformative. What I love about the owners of Powerful You, Steph and James, is that they're trying to make this affordable for everyone. That's a beautiful thing, because some of these seminars can be so, so expensive, and they're going downstream. I mean, if you can't afford this, they're making scholarship tickets at $25 for the entire weekend.
That's crazy.
Not each day.
The weekend.
$25 for the weekend.
That's insane.
That's three cups of coffee.
Insane.
So definitely check out powerful-u.com. Make sure that you join us, because you're not going to leave the same person that you came in. And that's what's exciting. But thank you so much. Good luck
thank
to you for your continued journey.
thank you so much. I appreciate you.
Chasing Glory with Lilian Garcia.
Well, Trent, no, the truth is I appreciate you. You know, I love that. As a matter of fact, I started using that now. When he said that to me, I appreciate you, it made me go, wow, that's really powerful. And I love that whole saying. So I've been telling that to people too and spreading that forward. I appreciate you. So Trent, I appreciate you. How cool was that interview? Did you guys get a lot out of it? I know I got a lot of stuff out of it. It was so liberating in a way, where you can celebrate. Guys, I always say that. I learned that too. Like, I was so hard on myself for so many years on trying to be perfect on everything. Perfect, perfection, perfect, perfection. There is no such thing. And yes, you can strive to be better, and that's cool, and that's great. No one's telling you not to do that. But when you succeed at something, when you get through something, let's say, just celebrate that moment. It's okay to do that. Give yourself a high five. Give yourself a pat on the back that you went through some fears. And maybe it wasn't perfect, but it's okay. You got through some fears and you did it anyway. And those are the things that are so beautiful. And I love the whole thing that Trent said. This quote is amazing. You can't silence your greatness to make other people feel comfortable. Whoa, that's a drop the mic moment. Seriously, that is true. You cannot silence your greatness. Don't do it. When you elevate, then you will help elevate others. Okay, they will look at you and they'll go, wait, if he did it, then I can do it. So keep elevating yourself and you'll see how others will elevate. But those that try to hold you down, You gotta get them off just like crabs. You gotta just say, okay, goodbye, see you later. Like, you're not in my wheelhouse of greatness in the fact that you want to rise with me. And so therefore, if you want to stay behind, you stay behind, but I'm moving forward. All right. Okay. So thank you so much, guys, for following the show, for the 5-star rating, for subscribing to the show, for telling people about this. Please make sure you tell some people about this. Wish me well. I can use all the prayers I can get. I need my voice this weekend so badly. So hopefully I can get through this respiratory infection really quick and get my full voice back so that I can also perform and do all the hosting that I need to do and the speaking. And then, of course, next week will be PFL 2 on May 23rd. We're back in New York, and it's just exciting to see the new divisions that are going to be competing against each other in the MMA world. Until then, make sure you follow me at Lilian Garcia on Instagram and Twitter. That's with one L in the middle. Lilian Garcia official fan page on Facebook and at Chasing Glory Podcast on Instagram. Go out there and live with much peace, love, and passion. And remember to always be yourself and trust that it's enough. All right, guys, have a great week. Bye.
Thanks for joining us here on Chasing Glory from executive producer Lilian Garcia. Don't forget to share this episode with your friends and be sure to subscribe at Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorite shows.